So this was pretty easy for you. Same thing. What about the rest of you? You are not making them, you're just building them for other people. So how did that just make you feel? Standing up to introduce somebody. Oh, actually, you didn't have to stand. So you really had it easy. You had to sit. You sat down and made some sense. Well, hopefully this will help you as well. I'm going to give you a lot of information that will help you as presenters. Or the information can be taken. You can take the information back to the people who are making the presentation so they can be a little bit better. Those are the people who really probably should be in a session like this, more so than those of you who are actually building the presentation. I'm going to give you a lot of information on presentation skills right up front because we will focus more so on PowerPoint. But some of you, according to the brochure, are expecting presentation skills. So I will cover some of that for you right up front. Let me ask you to do me a favor. In the front cover, you should have a blank space unless you have your own paper. Jot down your objectives for this session today. What do you expect to get out of this training today? List your objectives.
Everybody in that room is going to know this person does not
want to be here and they do not like what they're talking about. I love what I'm talking about. I love it, and it's going to come across. If you're in a job and you're required to make presentations as a part of your job, and you hate making presentations, you don't like the material, you need a new job. You need a new job, because if you don't enjoy it, again, it's not going to be effective in any way. Same thing with any job that you're doing. I remember I worked for Target in high school. I worked at Target, and I went away to school in Chattanooga. They let me transfer to a Target. I moved to L.A. They let me transfer to another Target, so I was happy. I was working. It was a good thing. But everybody in every single Target had the same attitude. I don't want to be here. This manager's making me mad. I'm sick of this. I don't like the customers. They're complaining. And I'm thinking, why are you in this job? If you don't want to be here, quit. It doesn't make sense. If you're not happy in what you're doing, you need to move on and do something else. You need to be in a position or a job or whatever you're doing. It needs to be something that benefits other people, and it also is self-fulfillment for you. If you, those two things are not happening, you are in the wrong, you're in the wrong area. I'm not telling anybody to go quit their job, but I'm just telling them you need to do things that you enjoy, okay? So I have to have some fun. Now, a lot of people have said to me that they can't have fun when they make their presentations because they have so much fear. How many of you have fear, just total fear of making a presentation or standing up in front of a group of people? Come on. This is good. I always get one hand that's, you can tell you are fearful because you don't even want to let us know. It's like, yeah, that is an issue. If you have fear, you got to identify what's causing that fear, address it, and then you're able to make the presentation. Nervousness is okay. If you're nervous, that's good. If you're not nervous, you don't need to stand up, because you're going to be too confident, and then you're going to pass out or something. We don't want you to get up there and look crazy. But I want you to make sure that you have a certain degree of nervousness, but the fear, you've got to let that fear go. I remember I sang, and I remember the first few times I sang in church, I was so scared. I used to just be nervous. And I had to realize, okay, something's causing this. I got to identify the fear. You have to identify what's causing the fear. For me, it was based on the fact I was comparing myself to other singers. Can't sing like Diane, can't sing like Erica. And when I realized that I could really sing, and that I don't sing like them, but I have my own style, you can't get the mic out of my hand now. Anytime somebody asks me to sing, I'm singing. Where you want me, funeral? I'll be there. Just like wherever I can sing, I'm going to do it now. Because I realized I can actually sing. I am not standing there overconfident. I'm still nervous, and people still ask me, how do you sing like that? You seem so relaxed. No, I'm not. If you saw my knees under my dress, you know, okay, she is a little bit nervous. So I gotta have that. If I don't have that, then I will not stand up and sing. If I'm not nervous, then I need to sit down, because it's gonna be real ugly. I'm gonna bomb. Same thing with presenting. You're gonna bomb every time. You're standing there and you're overconfident. But to help you get rid of fear, if you have that as an issue and you just didn't want to tell me today, the best way to get rid of fear, two things, and I want you to write these down, because I'm going to give you four things that are important to an effective presentation. Preparation and practice. Preparation and practice equals fearless. P plus P equals fearless. If you prepare and you practice your presentation, I tell you, it will come out absolutely perfect. This is not practicing. That is not practicing. How did I open up this morning? Good morning, I'm Angela Crutchfield. I want to tell you three things about myself. I'm happy, I'm healthy, and I'm blessed. If you know those three things about me, you know exactly who I am. I'm not defined by the things that I've accomplished in life. I'm defined by those three things. That's practicing. Everything that you plan to say, every movement that you plan to make, you need to practice it. Please practice with your equipment. If you're going to use an LCD projector, even if you're using overhead transparency, there's nothing worse than you standing there doing this. That's great. And you're fumbling. You don't want to do that. If you can get that equipment, practice with it. If you can't get the equipment, be creative. I had a lady who used her television. She was using overhead transparencies, and she was at home, and of course couldn't get the projector, so she put her television on a channel that had static and stuck her transparencies to the television and walked through her full presentation. Do what you have to do. You've got to practice that presentation from start to finish. Every movement, every word, everything that you're going to say, build it into that presentation during your prep time, which is the preparation part of it. You build all of that in, and then you practice everything that you plan to say. If you don't have an audience, if you can't pull together a group of people like in your office or something, Pull together your kids. You got four kids. That's a nice audience for you. Pull your kids together. Pull your plants together. Pull your cats, dogs, whatever you got to do. Pull them together to give yourself a feel of an audience. And that will help you more than you know. So if you are not practicing that presentation from start to finish, saying every word and practicing every movement, you are out of order. I'm going to tell you a lot of out of orders today. You're out of order. You need to practice all of those things. How many of you are actually putting practice in? You're practicing the way that I'm saying? Or are you sitting at the desk with the burning the midnight on? Not good. I've tried that, and that's not good. She said she mentally, which is basically what you're doing. You're sitting there. You figure, okay, maybe I can say this. There's nothing worse than throwing something in that wasn't already in a presentation. Nothing worse than trying to throw a joke in, and that joke is not very funny because you really don't know the joke. You're just going by what somebody told you. Not good. You want to practice those things. I'm going to give you a concept that I think will help you build all of those things into your presentation. Any stories, any jokes, any anecdotes, anything like that. You want to build those things in purposely. You don't want to just, I'm just going to throw this joke out there. Yeah, not good. Not good. Now, what I want you guys to do, I asked you already to be open. Open, you're gonna be open, right? Have a little activity I want you to do with me. Real simple little activity that we're gonna do. Got this from the album, Presentation, Powerful Presentation Skills. Preparation and practice, that is the key. Preparation and practice works for me. So you guys can go with me. Okay. Preparation and practice, that is the key. Preparation and practice. One more time. Preparation and practice, that is the key. Preparation and practice. One more time. Preparation and practice, that is the key. Preparation and practice works for me. You got to get that inside of you and believe that and know that if I prep time and I practice, it's going to come out perfect. I'm going to have a perfect presentation. And prep time is also doing research, doing your homework, finding out, getting the information. A lot of people are doing presentations and they don't even know what they're talking about because they haven't done the homework. Somebody just handed them a presentation. Here, Debbie, make this presentation. And you don't even know the stuff. Even if you get it at the last minute, spend as many hours of time as possible learning that material, finding out as much information as you can. Then you can open the floor up to questions and you're not out there looking crazy. You can say, okay, any questions? And you're ready for them. Okay? Keep those two things in mind. Now, a lot of people have asked me about styles. Where you fall as a presenter? Do any of you know where you fall as a presenter? What zone you fall into? And I'm gonna give you a description of these zones so you'll know. Now think about the best presenter you've ever seen. Think about the best presenter that you've ever seen. What did you like about that person? Relax. What else? Energy level. Funny. Knowledge. Dynamic. What else? Creative. I guess you don't have a lot of good presenters around. That's all I'm getting. Okay, think about the worst presenter. What did you not like about her?
Monotone.
Boring. What else?
Short
with people. What else? And what is Dr. Ray? Yeah, what else?
Confusing.
Okay.
Too many jokes.
Too many jokes. They're standing behind, or they're behind a podium. They're standing behind a podium and they got the notes right there. They're looking and they're reading. Barely looking at you, barely making eye contact with you. What else? Lack of knowledge. What else?
Poor grammar.
Stuttering. Certain filler words all too often.
Sorry?
Filler words.
And not saying anything after it. There are people who get stuck on the ums. I say and I know I do. And now you're probably gonna catch it. Because I just told you that I say and I shouldn't have told you that. But I know I do that. But it's not a I mean, there are some ums that can go on and on and gets a little bit ugly. Anymore, anything else that you did not like about certain presenters? That monotone is already, that's always the number one. Let me give you the zones. I want to read this. This is coming. I want you to jot this resource down. High Impact Presentation and Training Skills with Nikki Holiday. Great resource for presenters. Great resource for anyone that's making any type of presentation or training.
What was the name?
High Impact Presentation and Training Skills, Nikki Holiday. I want to read read real quickly a brief description of each of the zones, and then we'll see where you fall as a presenter. The cool zone presenter captures the audience's attention with clear-headed persuasiveness. During this type of presentation, things are orderly and stay under control. Presenters are often on a specific mission and can marshal arguments with military precision. The hot zone presenter. A hot zone presenter can blow the roof off a building. This is the type of person that audiences either like or dislike, but no one ignores. Presentations are fast and furious, delivered often at a rapid rate of speech. A presenter pushes passions to the limit and runs on adrenaline. The dull zone presenter. The dull zone presenter lacks the heat of the hot zone presenter and the incisive edge of the cool zone presenter. Dull presenters are afraid to take risks. Therefore, their presentations tend to be bland and boring. Now, where do you fall?
Okay. I'm a little bit between red and
purple. Oh, you're purple. I always get people say, can I be a purple? Okay, John, you can be a purple. How many are you blue zones? I'm sorry?
I must be a pink.
A pink.
Definitely gray, but slightly red.
Slightly red? Okay, that's different. How many of you think you are blue? You are falling into that blue zone? Probably. Red zone. Any red zones? How are you, Rick?
Yeah, pretty much more red.
Really? I had a guy yesterday, I was in Chattanooga, and the guy actually said he was a red zone, and nobody believed him. And we do a part where I have you all to come up and make presentations. Well, he made a presentation for his group, and he was definitely a hot zone. He was sitting in the back of the room. He came from the back of the room talking. Good morning, my name is John. And he was up from the two-minute presentation, the whole 2 minutes, he was up here the whole time. Not necessarily a good thing. Being a hot zone presenter is okay, but you want to create those waves in your presentation. You want to create those highs and lows. Don't always dip down to that gray zone, though. You don't want to go there too much, Danny. You want to kind of try and stay between the red and the blue. But you don't want to be like this the whole session all day. People are going to leave like this. You don't want them doing that. You want them to leave getting the information and feeling good about you as a presenter. Okay, so you want to balance the two. So being a purple is probably the best thing to do. You can drop down to the gray zone just a little bit, but don't go there too much, Jen. Try your best to stay out of there. Now, if you are a person, let me ask you a question. How many of you are using a podium when you stand up and talk? One podium? Sometimes?